Okay, you ready?
Yes.
Now.
A Peloton? Give it up for our first time riding.
All right, first ride. I'm a little nervous, but excited. Let's do this. 5 days in a row. You surprised?
I am. 6 a.m. Yay.
Rising with the sun.
That was totally worth it.
Let's go, Grace of Austin. 50 rides.
She just said my name. A year ago, I didn't realize how much this would change me. Thank you.
This holiday, give the gift of Peloton.
Hey, what's up? So you just watched a commercial that was aired in December 2019. And the question, of course, is what does this have to do with the International Business Law Program? Well, the Peloton case is one of the cases that we are going to discuss in more detail during the International Business Law 1 course. And this is why. So first, we had this commercial in 2019, and then I was basically attracted to this company because many things went wrong with this commercial. And of course, the first question to you is why? What went wrong? Now, what was very obvious is that most people, particularly on social media, didn't like the fact that the husband gave his wife a gift and basically forced her to do some exercise. And the question is, does she really need it, and does she really like it? Because when you watch this video back, you see that she was not very happy. At one point, she woke up 6 a.m., yeah. And if you look at this, this doesn't show a happy face. So it exploded on social media. And that had a huge impact, not only on the sales, but on the stock price. And now you see that, you know, from an international business law perspective, this becomes a more interesting case. So the here you see it, the Peloton saw $942 million in market value wiped out in a single day after the commercial was aired. Somebody else, Ryan Reynolds, he had a gin company called Aviation, and he then decided to hire the same actress for his commercial, where she was just enjoying a gin with two friends and say, well, I'm happy again, after she so-called like split up with the guy. That's what the impression is. So this became a hype on social media. It got viral. But then again, what does it have to do with lawyers, and why are we international business law program paying so much attention to this case? Now, it's not only because the stock price dropped, but that caught my attention. So I did some more research into this company, and then I figured out that this company for the International Business Law Program is actually excellent, because one of the things we are going to work on is a what we call venture capital investment. So this is an investment in a very young company. And when you look at what happened to this company, so first they did a so-called seed round for $400,000, then you got a Series A, which is second round, $3.5 million. Then they do a product crowdfunding, a Series B as a third investment round, a Series C, D, E, and F. You see the money that they attracted is increasing exponentially. And one thing that we do in the International Business Law Program, we are actually negotiating these contracts. So you have two groups negotiating against each other. One group will represent Peloton, the other one will represent the investor. And then we are going to draft the so-called term sheet and other legal documents. We are going to explain the difference between Series E, Series A, and Series B. How does product crowdfunding work? So this is all investment rounds in a non-listed company. But then in September last year, the company did a so-called IPO, an initial public offering. So now the shares are listed on a stock exchange and the public can invest in this company. And you see all of a sudden banking securities regulations coming in. So that also makes this company a fantastic case study in the International Business Law Program. But that's not all. Here we see that stock price didn't really move, but then all of a sudden we see there March, February, March 2020, 2020, it dropped a bit. It had everything to do with the COVID-19 crisis, but then all of a sudden it went up like crazy. And we can explain this because many people started to work out from home, and they were buying, obviously, they were buying fitness devices and equipment. But that's, again, not the most important thing. What is so interesting here is that the device that you see here is not just a home trainer. It's an Internet of Things device. It's connected. It collects data. It gives a lot of information to the consumer. It's a live streaming device. So this company is based in New York City. And many people, when they do these exercises, they want to go to these classes, but these classes are always full. And these days you can even not even go to these classes. So what if, that was one of the ideas, what if they are going to record them and have live streams so you can actually participate in these classes while just being at home. But if you cannot make it, you can also watch it later. The instructor, if it's a live stream, can actually see all the participants and interact and have a conversation with them as well. So this is a home traditional home trainer, but it's a streaming device like Netflix. It's a connected device. It uses data. You have some artificial intelligence tools. And they offer subscriptions. So it's so much more, and it has so many, let's say, international business law questions. One thing which is fascinating is that now this company is obviously outperforming some other big companies that we all know, like Amazon or Netflix or Adobe. You can better invest in Peloton these days. Not that I want to make any recommendation, of course, but now you see what they figured out is that medical doctors started to so-called prescribing this device to patients. And that means that it could become a medical device. What does it mean? What kind of rules and regulations do we see there? And in their governance, they came up with a health and wellness advisory council. How does that work? So when we look at the governance of the company, we have management level, we have the board of directors or supervisory board. Now we have a health and wellness advisory council. How does it work? And what's our role as business lawyers in setting this up? It's all fascinating. But the most important thing when we look at Peloton is that it's basically a manifestation of all other companies in the world. So here we see what happened from like the 90s, 2000s, 2010s, and now in 2020. So when we go to the 90s, you had these companies, and many of these companies were big, and it was almost impossible for smaller companies to compete against them. You had long product life cycles, steady industry environment, less need for innovation. But that changed with basically the exponential growth of technology. We see more emerging tech-driven products and services these days. And so most of these devices become smart. They offer services. We see new markets, new competitors. But now in the 2020s, we see a complete change of the status quo. So if you look at Peloton, we all would think, well, this is a home trainer, fitness device company. But it's actually becoming a data company and maybe even a medical company right now. And that means that they start competing with all kind of other medical companies. But if you then look at Amazon and Apple, they become medical companies and healthcare companies as well. So that's one thing that we will look into, is how is this company evolving and what's our role as a lawyer in this development from a startup company to a listed company to a whole ecosystem. Then we will look into environmental questions, health questions, questions of diversity and inclusivity. We will look at the changing boundaries that we see in industries. We will look at the changing world and the changed consumer behavior and what the impact is on the legal documents that we have to draft, the legal systems and the legal organizations that we have to build/create. So this company basically shows you the new normal. And that's why it's so important to look into this case. Now, one thing, if you are a very successful company in this whole new world, then you will see a lot of new competitors. And yes, we see new startups emerging like Hydro or Tonal, I don't know exactly how you pronounce it. But we also see that more established companies like Lululemon, which is a sports brand, apparel, sports apparel company, they acquired a startup company, Mirror. So we will look also into how does an acquisition work and what will actually happen when you integrate a young company into a bigger company. The other thing that happened, of course, it was even more important for a company like Peloton, is that Apple, which is one of the big tech companies, announced in August, I think, of this year, that they also going to offer a subscription where people can actually have fitness classes or stream fitness classes by using their iPhone. And if you have an Apple Watch like I have, you might then track things, record things, maybe interact with people. I don't know. But if that happens, this would be important for a company like Peloton. And then the question, of course, what can Peloton do? And how will it change its structure? And that's where lawyers really become important. And you see that Peloton is trying to do this. So on October 7th of this year, they had an opening. So a new position came up, a senior director, M&A, mergers and acquisitions, and technical diligence. And here you see that this person is looking and evaluating growth opportunities. So it's looking at M&A transactions, it's looking at partnerships, it's looking at alliances, it's looking at joint ventures. So in the International Business Law program, we are going to look at all these projects, like, you know, how does an M&A work? What kind of agreements do we see? How can you write a joint venture agreement? What's the difference between an alliance and a joint venture? But these were all like traditional ways for a company to grow. But if you go to the new ways, we see that companies actually become ecosystems, where we see that it's not only about acquisitions, joint ventures and alliances. We see all kind of other deal types. We see big companies investing in small companies. We see big companies using influencers to grow. We see all kind of arrangements between big companies and other stakeholders like consumers, and how consumers can actually become part of the product development of a company. It's all extremely fascinating. And then you say, okay, this is great. So we're going to look at the role of lawyers in this world. But that's the thing, the role of lawyers is not that obvious in that world, because a couple of years ago this report came out, how CEOs create and manage successful ecosystems. So Peloton is an ecosystem, it's very successful, it's growing, but it sees now all kind of new competition emerging. And what should this company do? Now, what was interesting in this report, that I think on page 7, it said, what shouldn't you do? So what not to do? And the first thing they said, what you shouldn't do, is bring in lawyers too early. And then I thought, what? So we business lawyers, we should not be part of this initially, because according to this report, we might actually kill the ecosystem. And that's obviously something we shouldn't do. So in the business law program, this Peloton case becomes so important, because it was a startup company. So we look at the startup aspects and our role there. Then it was doing an IPO. That's a whole legal process. We go and look into that as well. Then we look at, okay, it was a company, became an ecosystem. How does it work? But more importantly, what should we change as business lawyer in order to become important partners in this world? So the next report that we'll see is not what not to do, but the first thing that you should do is bring in the business lawyers. And during the program, we are going to teach you how to become a business partner, how to become a business lawyer that CEOs, managers, and other stakeholders within the company will actually go to immediately when they have one of these Peloton challenges. So I hope this is clear. I can, of course, continue, but then this lecture would take another hour. We are going to do that next year when I see you at the International Business Law Program in Tilburg. Thank you so much for being here. Should you, in the meantime, have any questions about Peloton or about the program, here are the ways you can connect with me. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, and hope to see you again or see you soon. Bye.